Let's look at, so remember we're looking at history taking. Okay, so far we've looked at an introduction. Okay, number two, we've looked at how to collect demographics or what about that, about the patient, right? So now let's look at the third part, which is the presenting complaints. Okay, presenting what? Complaints. Okay, presenting complaints, these are usually the either the signs or symptoms, okay, that the patient has noticed to be affecting them. Okay, the patient will not be able to tell what exactly is wrong with them. They will not be able to give you the diagnosis. Okay, so they can only say, no, I'm having a headache, or maybe I'm having I'm coughing, and so on and so forth. Okay, so they will not tell you that, no, I'm having, let's say, maybe pneumonia. They will not even know that they're having pneumonia. Okay, they will not know that. They only say that I'm having a fever, and so on. Right. So when we say presenting complaints, we are talking about either the signs, okay, and or symptoms, okay, noticed by the patient, okay, by the patient. In the case of pediatrics, by the mother or the next of kin or someone else, okay, that is what we call the presenting complaints. Okay, now there's this word noticed, that they have noticed something, that they have noticed, okay, meaning that there could also be something that they have not noticed, okay, and it's up to you to be able to dig deeper and find out even what they have not noticed. Okay, so they can, now I hope we know this, the difference between signs and symptoms. Okay, signs and symptoms, these are things that, these are manifestations of disease that can be noticed, okay, or rather that can be noticed by either feeling, okay, they can be felt, or they can be seen by the patient, okay, by the patient themselves. Then those things that are only elicited by the health practitioner. Elicited by what? By health practitioner. Symptoms, they are noticed by the patient themselves. Okay, some of these they can overlap. Some of them can overlap. Okay. In the case of fever, okay, a patient will tell you that, oh, I'm feeling hot. Okay, I'm feeling hot. Feeling hot not because of the weather, but because of the disease, right? And then when they come to the hospital, you get the thermometer and you check their temperature. You find that indeed they're having what? In a fever. So some of them they can. It is a sign, but it is able to be noticed by. By the patient, isn't it? It means. Now, what we need to note, presenting complaints. Okay, so when the patient comes to the hospital, you get out data, you do introduction, you introduce yourself, and so on and so forth, you get about data, and then you ask the patient what has brought you to the hospital. Okay, now, in the case of presenting complaints, the patient will most likely mention first what is affecting them the most. Okay, they can be having maybe a wound on their toe, okay, but it's not really affecting them much. According to them, it's not affecting them much, and they're all at the limits. So most likely they're getting headache first, even though it was a wound on the toe. So an aspect of severity, chronicity. Okay, so other literatures or other complaints in the order of severity, say you order of chronicity. Okay, now sometimes what you can do, you can list those presenting complaints and you attach the duration of each symptom or each complaint. For example, if it's headache, okay, you say headache for, let's say, 7 days. All right, 7 days. Usually we use a shortcut, Instead of writing, maybe like in the clinical setup, because you don't have enough time to be writing everything and so on, but you use something that is universally understood by in the whole. So you can say times 7/7, meaning that 7 days out of 7 days, okay, a week are 7 days, okay? Then maybe you say number one. Number two, you can say maybe vomiting. Okay, vomiting, let's say maybe 3/7. So this way, it means that the patient has been vomiting for how many days? 3 days. Okay, then you can also, for example, leg swelling. Okay, leg swelling for, let's say maybe 2 months. Okay, 2 out of 12. Remember, there are 12 months in a year. Okay, so we're just using those shortcuts now. So you can see here that the swelling is the one that started first. But according to the patient, that wasn't a big issue. It didn't give them much problem. Patients, most of the times, they come to the hospital when it's paining. Okay? If something is not really paining, it's not giving them much problem. Even if it is deadly, most of the times, they'll stay. They'll help to survive. Okay? So that's about that. So, like I mentioned, the most likely mentioned things according to the severity, what is affecting, what is giving them much problem, okay? So you need to see how long each of those complaints has been there. Now, other than that, the other thing that you should also understand here is that, right, you need to write in the patient's own words, okay? No medical jargon. Okay, you don't need to use what? Medical jargon. For example, on leg swelling, isn't it? On leg swelling, it's only one that is swollen, all right? And then you want to say unilateral, okay, unilateral lower limb. Lower limb edema. Okay, so you can see that we are basically talking about one and the same thing, but you don't go for the medical language, you don't go for the medical jargon, you prefer using on what? Okay, because the patient will tell you that I'm having unilateral lower limb. No, they're not going to tell you that. They'll say, oh, my leg is swelling. Okay, so you use the patient's own words. Okay, so that's about it. So with presenting complaints, you just list the complaint without explaining much about it. The only thing include is the duration of symptom. That's all. Okay, that's all you can include. So you get a lot of things under complaints. Okay, let's look at the history of complaints. History of presenting complaints. History of presenting complaints. Now, under history of presenting complaints, you ask open-ended questions. Okay? You ask what? Questions. Open-ended questions, these are questions that will give the patient opportunity to explain what's affecting them. Okay? It will give them opportunity to explain in their own words what is affecting them. For example, you can ask questions such as, when last were you well? Okay? Or when did you started feeling this way? Or when did you notice this symptom? When did you stop feeling well? Okay? So they're going to tell you, oh, it was on such a day I was doing this. Alright? Now, most of the times on this, we use a mnemonic, Socrates. Most of the times, this is applied much in cases of pain. Okay? It's applied much in cases of pain, but we can use it as a guide. We can use it as a guide in it, developing the history of presenting complaints. Now, you ask open-ended questions, right? The open-ended questions. For each and every symptom that was mentioned in the history of presenting complaint. So you start talking about, like in that case, we mentioned headache, okay? So when did you notice the headache? When did the headache start, okay? Which part of the head is most affected? You know that headache may not involve the whole head. There could be some regions of the head that may be spared and so on. And that may give you a clue as to what is affecting the patient. So the site, okay, the onset, when did this problem start? When did it start, okay? And then the character, okay? What is the character of the pain? Is it sharp pain, okay? Is it a thrombin pain? Is it a dull pain? What kind of pain is it? So when you know the kind of pain that the patient is having, it's also going to help you to come up with a diagnosis. Then R is for radiation. Is that pain being felt anywhere else? What is it being transferred somewhere else? Okay. So you understand that sometimes sometimes the origin of the pain, okay. Excuse me, just let me just pause the video. Alright, so I was talking about history of present complaints, okay. So some of the things that you need to ask before I mention about each of the complaints that were mentioned in the previous segment. So number one, you can ask about questions such as, what was the main problem that made you want to see a doctor? Why did the patient come to the hospital in the first place? Okay, I've already mentioned. Then when did you first notice the problem? Okay, so they tell you that I have a headache. Like I mentioned, you ask when first they noticed that they were having a headache. Then you also ask, the problem has changed. Okay. Now, you talk about the progression. Okay. Progression of the symptom. Okay. Has it gotten worse or better? Okay. Has it gotten worse or better? So I was talking about this mnemonic Socrates. Okay. So S is for sight, O is for onset, C is character, R is for radiation, and I was saying that under radiation, you can find that the pain. For, let me give an example. In the case of acute appendicitis, right? You know that the appendix is in the right iliac fossa, all right? But instead of the pain originating from the right iliac fossa, you find that the pain is originating from the umbilical region and radiating to the right iliac fossa. So if this is the abdomen, okay, and then you have those segments of the abdomen. So right iliac fossa is this side, okay, and then the periumbilical maybe somewhere there. So you see that it is starting from around that region, and then it is radiating to the right iliac fossa. Okay. So it doesn't mean that the origin of it doesn't mean that what's causing the pain is necessarily there, okay? What is causing the pain is actually in the right iliac fossa, okay? So that's about radiation. You can also think of things such as angina and so on, right? Then we have associated what? Signs and symptoms, okay? Associated signs and symptoms. Now, under associated symptoms, okay, associated signs and symptoms, here this is where now, let me mention of this, okay, you have to exhaust the system that is affected by that particular sign or symptom. For example, we are talking about headache, okay, we had headache, we also had what, there was vomiting. Okay, and there was what? Leg swelling. Okay, there was leg swelling. So now, headache, we know that headache is much to do with CNS. Okay, it's much to do with CNS. Then, but headache can be caused by any other problem in some system, right? But it's more to do with CNS. So as you are asking about headache, for example, you ask about the site of the headache, which part of the head is most affected, when did it start, what is the character of the headache, okay, is the headache being thought anywhere else, okay, is it relating to somewhere else in the body, okay? When you come to associated signs and symptoms, in the case of CNS, okay, you ask things such as, for example, are you also having convulsions? Okay, any history of convulsions? But of course, you're not going to say convulsions. The patient may not understand what you're talking about, okay? So you say, for example, fitting or abnormal movements, okay? Or abnormal movements. You can also talk about, for example, things such as fainting, okay? Things such as fainting, okay? You can also talk about things such as visual, okay? Visual disturbance. Okay, you can talk about things such as impaired balance, okay, and movement. Okay, so you can ask about things that are relating to the CNS, okay, the central nervous system, okay. So it means that if you ask such questions, someone is having a headache, and then you ask questions that are related to the central nervous system. So you find that the patient is having convulsions, okay, or abnormal movements. They're also having visual disturbances, okay. You may discover that maybe the problem they're having is to do with the CNS. If you start talking about vomiting, when did the vomiting start, for example, okay? What is the cause of the vomit? Okay? And so on. Okay? Then, under associated signs and symptoms, you can start asking about it. Is this more to do with GIT, right? So you start asking for symptoms that are manifested in a GIT condition. Okay? So other than vomiting, you can find that there's loss of appetite. There could be maybe constipation, there could be abdominal pain, there may be jaundice, so on and so forth, okay? So you ask about questions that are related to GIT. About associated signs and symptoms. So we'll talk about more about of this when you look at the review of symptoms. I think that one I'm going to give you as your assignment. I'm going to look at this. Okay, leg swelling, similarly, you ask. This one may be due to GIT. It can also be due to CVS, okay, the cardiovascular system. So since you've already asked about things to do with GIT, so you're not going to again ask about GIT on leg swelling, in as much as leg swelling can be associated with GIT. Okay, so you can ask about CVS and maybe. The renal, okay, the kidney, things to do with the urinary system, the GUT, okay, you can ask about those things. Now, what happens is that whichever system you exhaust under history of presenting complaints, okay, if you ask questions related to the CNS, related to the GIT, related to CVS, and related to GIT, it means that when you come to review of systems, there is going to be no need of you asking questions relating to these systems again. The only system that you're probably going to ask about is the respiratory system, because and maybe the musculoskeletal system, because you've not asked about that under history of presenting complaints. Okay, that is going to be repetition. So, associated signs and symptoms. Okay, or rather, let me go through that history of presenting complaints. You exhaust each symptom that was mentioned by the patient in the presenting complaints. Okay, so in our example, there was headache, there was vomiting, and leg swelling. So you start with headache, okay? You start with headache. I'm going to give you a more practical example later on, maybe in the next lesson or so. You start with headache. When the headache started and so on and so forth, then you go to vomiting, you go to leg swelling, okay? Under associated signs and symptoms, that's why you now review the system concerned with that particular symptom, okay? With that particular symptom. Under this, when you're asking for associated signs and symptoms, you ask closed-ended questions. These questions, they just involve yes or no. For example, you ask, are you having convulsions? The patient says no. Have you fainted? Any history of fainting? The patient says, yes, I fainted on such a day. So maybe unless it's prompting you to ask further, if let's say the patient says yes, and then you want to ask further, what happened when you fainted and so on. Okay, if the patient says, yes, I convulsed on such a day, you ask further concerning what? Convulsions. Okay. Otherwise, associated signs and symptoms is basically systems review. Okay. And under systems review, you do what? You ask closed-ended questions. Okay. Then from associated signs and symptoms, you talk about timing. Okay. There are certain signs and symptoms that are going to be worse at particular times of the day. For example, in the case of asthma, okay, in the case of asthma, it may be worse in the evenings or at night, okay? Maybe worse in the evenings or at night. Or maybe the patient comes, okay, and they say, oh, I've been noticing that my legs are swelling, like we have in this case, okay? And then you ask further, you find that also they are also having swelling on the face. The patient is also having swelling on the face. Okay, what is called periorbital edema. And then you ask the question: when is this swelling worse? At what time of the day is it the swelling worse? For example, in the case of nephrotic syndrome, you will find that this periorbital edema is worse around morning time and subsides maybe somewhere after 10 hours. At 10 a.m. and so on, okay? It resolves and so on. The following day, the same. Find that the patient is waking up, the face is swollen. As the day progresses, it subsides and so on, all right? So that is going to give you a clue as to what the patient is suffering from. So that is about timing, okay? What else? Exacerbating factors and relieving factors. Exacerbating and relieving factors. Exacerbating and relieving factors. These are things that either make the symptom worse or better. Okay? So, for example, let's say the patient is vomiting much, maybe when they eat. Okay? Let's say the patient eats and then they vomit almost everything. All right? Or maybe there could be some types of pain. If they're in certain positions, they feel the pain gets worse. When they're in certain positions, they feel better and so on. So they're going, or maybe when they eat, the pain is worse. Or if they don't eat, that's when the pain is worse. All those are going to give you clues of what is affecting the patient. Then S there is for severity. Okay? Severity, you may in more literate patients, in patients that are more literate, you may ask questions. For example, you can say, on a score of out of 10, okay, how much would you say the pain is, or rather this symptom is affecting you? Okay, those that are literate enough, they can say, oh, maybe 5 out of 10, they can say, oh, 10, 8 out of 10, and so on and so forth, all right? Then, in those patients that are not so literate, okay, you can ask about the daily activities. How has the symptom affected their daily activities? So, for example, if this patient says, I'm even failing to walk, to go to the market. I can only walk a shorter distance. Okay, so you know that, okay, yes, the pain, if it's pain, yes, it's there, but not too much to affect much of the activities. But if the patient says, this pain is even making me wake up at night, because of the pain, I'm even waking up at night, it means that the pain is really worse. It's really bad. Most of the times, you are able to, if you are to score, you can say that is that kind of pain is maybe 10 out of 10. Okay, the patient can say, no, I'm not even able to go to for work. Okay, it's severe enough, but not as severe as in a case where someone is even waking up at night. Okay, because of the pain. Okay, so that's about it. History of presenting complaints. All right, history of what? Presenting complaints. Now, The other thing that we can talk about is the review of systems. Okay, the review of systems. Now, I'm not going to go deep to talk about the review of systems. I'm just going to give a guide on what exactly you look out for. Review of systems. Now, the reason why you are reviewing systems is that the body or other systems are not independent of each other, okay? A problem occurring in one system may affect the other system as well. Let me give you a common example. You've heard of what is called copomonale, okay? Where someone is having what? Maybe a problem in their lungs, maybe it could be asthma or so, okay? And then because of that, it causes right-sided heart failure. So a problem in the respiratory system causes a problem in the cardiovascular system, okay? Or it could be maybe in the case of cancer, you may have metastasis. Maybe you have a cancer in the lungs, and then it moves and goes to the brain, okay? And so on and so forth, all right? So the reason why you need to review the systems is to make sure that the problem is in one system that you've already looked at under the history of presenting complaints is not affecting another system somewhere else, another system rather, okay? So that is that. Now, here you ask closed-ended questions. Okay, for example, in our example, in the complaints that we had, we can see that when we are looking at the history of presenting complaints, one of the systems that was not really involved in any of those was the respiratory system. Okay, so you can ask, for example, you can ask questions such as, are you coughing? Okay, the patient will say yes or no. Okay, if the patient says, yes, I'm coughing, you can ask further. Is it productive? Okay, sputum. Okay, sputum. They'll say yes or no. Okay, then you can ask about hemoptysis. Okay, of course, you will not mention, you will not say hemoptysis. You are going to say, is the sputum stained with blood or are you coughing out blood? The patient will say yes or no. Okay? So it's just yes or no. All right? Then you can also ask, for example, what else? Dyspnea. Okay? Are you having any difficult breathing? They'll say yes or no. If they say yes, then you can go further to ask, so that you know more about the dyspnea that they're having, so that you're even able to grade the dyspnea and so on, all right? Then you can also ask about maybe things like chest pain. Are you having chest pain? They say yes or no. If they say yes, you ask further according to Socrates. Okay, you can ask further according to Socrates. The site, the onset, the character of the pain, the radiation, associated signs and symptoms, the timing, exacerbating factors, then the severity. You ask about all those, okay? Then, other than that, you can also ask about things such as fever, okay, night sweats. Okay, what about constitutional symptoms, night sweats, weight loss. Weight loss, okay, and so on and so forth. So they're going to answer yes or no. If they say yes, then you can ask further, okay? So on coughing, if the patient says, no, I'm not coughing, will you start asking if they're producing sputum? Honestly, no, okay? Because if they're not coughing, then obviously there's no sputum. Most likely there's no sputum. Or if they say they're not having a chest pain, and then you say, where is the pain? Guys, how? Okay? So, that's about review of systems. So, in your time, make sure that you know the signs and symptoms, okay? Okay, in this case, we're talking about symptoms related with the respiratory system, the CVS, the CNS, okay? Then the GIT, GUT, then we have the musculoskeletal system, and yeah, those. Then there could also be maybe hematological system. Okay, but mainly these. Okay, so know those. Once you know the signs, the symptoms that are related with it, those systems, then you can do a very good what? Systems review. Because you're basically asking if they're having any of the symptoms that are found in a disease affecting those systems. Okay, so that's about it, systems review. Let's look at past medical history and drug history. I think I'm going to probably end on drug history. And then we'll do the family history and others later on. Okay, so let's look at past medical history. So past medical history, basically what you want to assess is whether a condition that the patient has had in the past is either, if it's either a recurrence of the same condition or it's a complication, okay, of what is happening at that moment. For example, let me give an example. A patient had a sore throat, okay? Maybe it's a child that has a sore throat. And then the patient comes in with joint pains, okay? You know about rheumatic fever, okay? Maybe they're having joint pains, this chest pain, and so on and so forth, okay? And then you're able to relate that probably it's because of that sore throat that the patient had, okay? That is why they're having, so it is, or maybe, for example, they come with features of maybe acute renal failure, or maybe a nephrotic or nephritic syndrome, okay? So you're able to tell that, oh, maybe it was because of something like that, that's why they're having this. So you want to assess whether it's a recurrence or what you have at that moment is a complication of what was there in the past, okay? You want to assess recurrence or complication, as well as improvement, okay? Rather, the progress of previous treatments, okay? Of previous treatments. So now, here what you want to ask are questions such as, have you had any condition in the past? Has there been any condition? Have you been to the hospital? Have you had anything that made you to go to the hospital in the past? Okay? Okay? So any past conditions that made you go to the hospital? Any previous admissions? Okay? Any surgical procedures? Now, even procedures that you may overlook may be important, okay? For example, in females, it's common to have a CS, cesarean section. In males, it's common to have male circumcision, okay? All those, you can ask about them, all right? First, previous admissions to the hospital, you can ask the reason. Why were they admitted? What was wrong? And when? Okay, and how long they stayed in the hospital. Okay, and how long they stayed in the hospital. All right, then surgical procedures, you can ask about the outcome. Okay, you can ask about the outcome and the reason, by the way, the reason for that procedure, okay, and so on. Now, the reason, like I mentioned, the reason why I also ask about the surgical procedures is just in case it could be a recurrence or a complication of that surgical procedure that was done in the past. Okay. Then, a history of any chronic illness. Okay. Any chronic illness. Here we use the mnemonic just for you to be able to remember. The mnemonic deaths. Okay. D for diabetes mellitus. D for diabetes mellitus. E is for epilepsy. Those are common, probably the commonest chronic illnesses. Epilepsy, any history of epilepsy, history of asthma, T, history of tuberculosis, H, history of hypertension, then S is history of sickle cell disease. Okay? So usually if you are going through patient files, especially in our setting, you'll find that let's say maybe they can put a plus. If they put a plus on top, that means that there's history of diabetes. Then they can put a minus or maybe a zero, okay? Zero, 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 zero. So in such a case, it means that the patient only has a diabetes. Okay, if they put a plus also maybe on sickle cell, it means that the patient has a sickle cell and so on. Okay. So that is on past medical history. Then drug history. Okay, drug history. By the way, the other one that I shouldn't forget is HIV. Very common. HIV. Okay? Very common. Okay? Is the patient HIV positive or negative? Now, the reason why you are asking about all these, like I've mentioned, is it could be a recurrence or a complication, or you also want to know the progress of treatments. Okay? Has the patient been taking medication that have been prescribed, or they haven't been taking? Okay? Let's look at